Hello, my name's Benjamin J. Butler. I'm joined, and I'm an independent futurist. I'm joined here by my friend Chip Comins, who is the founder of Our Day and the American Renewable Energy Institute at an incredible, I think, moment of history with everything's going on in the world. Welcome, Chip.
Hi, Benjamin. Thank you for inviting me.
Well, to get us in the mood, we're going to put on a very brief video here, if you'll bear with me.
We have a lot of scarce resources today, but I think the scarcest of all is time.
We want a planet that works for us, and we have been doing a terrible job of taking care of it.
I think in the United States today, we've got an immediate opportunity because of an immediate problem.
We built our entire society on quote-unquote cheap oil.
Our physical world can no longer sustain how we've been doing it for the past 150 years.
No civilization has ever survived the ongoing destruction of its environmental support systems, nor will ours.
It's an experiment that I would rather see us not make.
Climate change is only a political issue in America.
Don't listen to, you know, some talk radio guy breaking it down for you. Go and do some research yourself.
Because if you don't believe climate change is happening, you just haven't read the science.
When we talk about building a low-carbon economy, that's a serious proposition.
We don't have the political will. We don't have the market mechanisms that we need.
We're spending over $300 billion a year importing petroleum and petroleum products into the United States.
We haven't had an energy policy in this country in the last 40 years, and it's time we get one.
Right now, the global climate challenge has exposed to us that we've got an economy that's slowly killing us.
You cannot have healthy kids in an unhealthy world, in a fundamentally unhealthy world, which we will be living in.
The real danger is that we don't get started. The rest of the world is starting to move. If we get moving, there's nothing that can stop the American people from getting a job done.
Okay. Well, that video was produced by Our Day and the American Renewable Energy Institute with a number of members of the board of trustees speaking. So Chip, welcome again. I'd love to ask you, what was the genesis of Our Day, and what inspired you to create it all those years ago?
Well, thanks for asking, Benjamin. And as you can see from the film that we just screened, that I am a filmmaker. That's one of the hats I wear in life. And it was in the making of a film for the National Renewable Energy Laboratory and its division called the National Wind Technology Center about first utility wind turbine to be owned by a Native American Indian tribe back in 2003, that I became first aware of the tremendous resource of the wind, of the value of renewable energy. And so as I went through the process of understanding that the United States could produce literally half of the energy that it uses by tapping into the wind that just blows through Native American reservations, and particularly in the North Dakota, South Dakota, Montana, parts of Wyoming and Nebraska area, what we call the Saudi Arabia of wind in the United States, that it was a no-brainer. Why don't we do this? We knew back at the beginning of this 21st century and well before that, that the greenhouse gases were disturbing and literally collapsing the biosphere, and that we needed to stop the burning of fossil fuels, meaning oil, coal, and gas. And so from that film that I did for the U.S. government, had the nice government stamp on it, called Wind Powering Native America, was born our day, the American Renewable Energy Day.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, I'm sure as we talk, a lot of the history of our day will come up, because certainly the history in this century, at least, of the whole Green Revolution runs parallel to the history of our day. And you've had some amazing people at your conferences, from Jimmy Carter to pretty much everyone in the field. You and I met on the edge of COP26. I was going to ask you, yesterday you and I spoke about where the Paris Accord was agreed, have a little video for us to put up to give you an opportunity to talk about your relationship with COP and of course COP26. Where is this?
Well, I'd like to say that as you're finding that video, which I think is something that we just did in Glasgow, my relationship with the COP began in 2008 in Copenhagen, where I produced 13 side events inside the official Bella Center. And that was where the world was poised. Remember, this is right when George Bush left office and Barack Obama was taking office in the United States. And we were ready ostensibly to make the great transition happen. So this video is something that was produced by my colleague, Luis Ahoyos, who won the Oscar for The Cove with his partners over at Obscura. And I'm part of this team called Projecting Change, where we project images onto globally recognized iconic structures like the Empire State Building, the Vatican, and the United Nations. And so you'll see some of that here. But in the doing, please know, those that are watching and joining us, that we were able to attain over 4.5 billion media impressions when we projected on the Vatican.
I mean, I look at a video like that, and then you projected stuff at COP26, and it really hits home to me that we are living in at this moment of great transition. So is something still making noise there? There we go. Sorry, I had to switch that off in the background. I look at something like that, and it really gives me hope. I think Chip and I speak fairly frequently, and I think we've agreed. Correct me if I'm wrong. We're neither pessimists nor optimists. We're somewhere in the middle. Pragmatic optimists, I think a word came up yesterday. I want to say that the situation from my perspective is incredibly dire. Just this week, I saw a report from the UN World Meteorological Organization on the state of global climate, with oceans which absorb 90% of the heat. We're seeing record temperatures there. Sea levels hitting record highs in 2021. The acidity of oceans, the worst they've been in 26,000 years. And of course, CO2 levels, concentrations, 50% higher than the pre-industrial revolution. And Africa facing the worst drought in 40 years, potentially. And of course, we all know about the collapse in biodiversity and the sixth extinction. The list goes on. We are obviously in a very, very serious situation. I was overseas, not planning to go back to the UK, and I was asked to come back for COP26, partly for an involvement with a UN group, but also to help create dialogues between indigenous leaders from across North and South America and visionaries that were attending COP. And that's how our paths crossed, Chip and mine. What was your feeling from COP?
Well, Benjamin, it was quite a an amazing feat to bring the world together in between the first two waves of COVID and to have a meeting. You know, we did 16 consecutive R-Day summits in Aspen, Colorado, starting in 2004, but we were knocked out in 2019, like most people in the convening business. And we haven't actually reconvened. I think we're going to be doing our 17th R-Day in August in Boulder, Colorado, in partnership with Colorado University. But that hasn't even been fully greenlit yet. It looks like it's going to be happening. However, the fact that the UNCCC could do COP26 in Glasgow was a miracle, truly a miracle. And you know, as well as everybody else that was there, that we had to do the lateral flow COVID test every single day to get into through the checkpoint, Charlie, green, blue zone, et cetera. And it happened and it pulled up. I'm not saying that the virus didn't spread there, but it was this window that the world chose to meet, and I think it was a really important thing in that. World leaders were able to come together inside the Armadillo building in Glasgow, Scotland. I was very active helping to produce some panels inside the Blue Zone in the first week with my colleague Keith Tuffley, who works over there with City Group. And we were able to bring in Shea Bastida, one of the world's leading climate youth activists, along with Greta Thunberg and Jerome Foster and Alexandra Villasenor. These are the top recognized youth that are being offered the microphone, the platform. Shea was offered to speak at the plenary in Glasgow to the world's leaders. And a year before that, on Earth Day, President Biden invited her to speak as part of his virtual climate summit that included Vladimir Putin, Xi Jinping, Boris Johnson, all of the rest of the world's leaders. And then you had, you know, 19-year-old Xie, who was introduced by Secretary of State Anthony Blinken, and she spoke very eloquently about the fact that it's their future, all the 20-year-olds on the planet, all the 19-year-olds on the planet, all the 7-year-olds, like your daughter, on the planet, are looking at this issue and saying, hey, what about me? What's it going to be like when I'm 50 years old? I want to have a family. I want to have the same life that you had, mom and dad, granddad. And so they see this. And so the urgency of now is very, very, very dynamic. And the COPs are put in place in order for us to come together as a world of 193 nations and figure out who's emitting the most greenhouse gases, who's emitting the least, and how can we come together in a world economy and stop emitting the 40 billion tons of greenhouse gases per year that are adding to the 3 trillion that have already been put up there, 70% of which has been released in the last 30 years alone due to the excessive overpopulating of the planet. Remember that the human population has gone from 2 billion in 1915 to 8 billion in 2020. And that is the greenhouse gas graph along with the human population graph, and they track each other and feed off of each other, in my opinion. So back to the COPs that came out of the conference in Rio in 1992 that produced the COP system at the United Nations. It was led by Maurice Strong back then. And now we're up to COP 27. But the conference in Rio in 1992 spun out of the conference that's taking place in Stockholm in 2 weeks. Stockholm plus 50, which was actually first established in 1972. So to say that, you know, we've been aware of the situation, you know, since I was a teenager, far, far before that. And now we're at this sort of tipping point where the feedback loops are coming fast and furious. We know what's happening with the weather systems, et cetera. And I think that the COP that's going to happen in Egypt in November is extremely important, but that's going to be based on what happens in New York City in September at the United Nations General Assembly in what they call Climate Week, where the world will come to New York. And these are two nodes on what we call at AREI, the climate constellation. As we go around the planet to these very important meetings, including this one virtually here today at Horasis, but also at WEF, at the World Future Energy Summit in Abu Dhabi that I've attended twice, and others around the planet. And let's not leave out the very important meeting on biodiversity that occurred in China recently. And so it's all linked together. But just to finish my thought on COP 26 in Glasgow, where you and I first began dialoguing and where we met, thanks to Eve, who introduced us. And also I traveled, it's duly note that I traveled to Scotland with Mindahi Bastida, who is Shie Bastida's father. He's Otomi Toltec. So I had a very deep indigenous interest and connection while I was in Scotland for the COP. But I've had that actually most of my adult life. I dare say Arde came out of my work with the indigenous people in North and South Dakota. So I think we must be cognizant of the failure of COP, but also not to forget the success. And that the Minga came to Glasgow, meaning the indigenous people of the world, to make sure that their voice was heard and at the table. And these are the people that are really kept out of the high-level meetings. And it's very difficult for them to get their voices heard. But the indigenous people of the planet are literally the last stop between humanity and the remaining biosphere. that science, E.O. Wilson and the leading scientists, you know, half Earth, nature needs half, are saying we must preserve the remaining 50% of the remaining biosphere in order to be viable life on the planet. And so the indigenous people, their reservations, their preserves, their traditional territories all around the world are sort of the last firewall between the growing human population. And so it's really, really time to recognize that fact and to pay attention to indigenous wisdom and what they're saying.
Yeah, absolutely. And it was very encouraging at COP26 to see the presence of so many of the indigenous elders at so many different forums, as well as the youth leaders. So we'll probably circle back to that towards the end. Next, I was going to ask you, what do you personally think the solutions are in terms of technology? So I know our day is agnostic and embraces all renewables, but I was, when I was doing a bit more research for my book, and partly because I came back to the UK, I've lived overseas for a couple of decades, and seeing how, you know, I've placed a lot of faith on solar, and quite frankly, years ago, I was so horrified and thought that the prices might not come down quick enough. And because of various other bottlenecks, I was sort of privately praying for some new, completely out of the box, new technology, sort of a Nikola Tesla type of free energy breakthrough, which could still happen. But one observation I've had is how offshore wind, how cheap that has become. For example, according to a Lazard report in November 2020, the levelized cost of energy for offshore wind was £63. Sorry, this is pounds, not dollars. Pounds per megawatt hour. Onshore wind, £30, and solar, £27. Versus new nuclear, £121. And that was very similar to numbers coming out of Bloomberg New Energy Finance and other analysts. Where do you place your faith, Chip?
Well, Benjamin, when we started our day in 2004, there was 2,500 megawatts of utility scale wind installed in the United States. Today, we've surpassed 150,000 easily. And with another 150,000 on the drawing boards now that offshore wind has come. Now, that at that time, 18 years ago, wasn't even competitive with coal. Now, coal's not competitive with wind. And solar has come on in 2015 to the extent where it's even more price effective than wind energy. So it's below 3 cents a kilowatt hour, as example. And the fact that once you put in the solar fields, hopefully in hundreds of acres, or once you put in the wind farms, hopefully in hundreds of megawatts, that you now are able to produce electricity without burning any fossil fuels or putting any greenhouse gases, more importantly, into the atmosphere. And so that constitutes the fastest growth sector of the utility scale electricity business in the United States. Wind has been growing faster than any other sector. That's coal, gas, oil, nuclear, hydro, you know, all of them. Wind, solar is now competing with wind for that title. And so it only makes sense as an economic model, and all of the big utilities are doing that. I want to talk quickly about the Colorado mob model, because it's very impressive what we've accomplished here. So in 1978, when President Jimmy Carter was in power, he wanted to start something called the Solar Energy Research Institute. And he put solar panels on the White House, as we all know. There were solar hot water heaters. And when he lost power and Ronald Reagan got into office and he took the panels off, that began another trend. But when Carter was in power, our Congressman Tim Worth went to him and said, we want to have SERI, Solar Energy Research Institute, located in Colorado, which we achieved, even though many other states were competing for that. And SERI quickly was turned into NREL, National Renewable Energy Laboratory, in the early 80s, where it's been doing very good work since that time. But that led to, in 2004, the first voter-mandated renewable portfolio standard in the United States, where the voters actually mandated that the utilities get a certain percentage, a small percentage, about 10% by 2030, I think it was. And the utilities fought that, kicking and screaming. They spent millions of dollars trying to defeat that measure at the ballot, but they lost, and then they were laughing all the way to the bank because they realized how much money they could make. And so XL Energy and Public Service Utility of Colorado is one of the leading wind energy installers in the United States as a result of that law, that voter mandated renewable portfolio standard, RPS. So going forward, that gave Governor Ritter, who ran on the New Energy Economy platform, an opportunity to become the governor of Colorado in 2006. He served 4 years, but in that 4 years, the last 2 years of the Bush administration, the first 2 years of the Obama administration, he achieved 57 clean energy bills. And Colorado has become one of the de facto leaders in this transition from fossil to renewable in the United States, in a state that is very heavily fossil fuel dependent for its economy. We have a lot of natural gas and we have a lot of oil and coal in the state of Colorado. So a state that was deep red went to purple politically and ultimately ended up being blue as a result of this. Now we're trending a little bit back towards the purple side. I myself am not a Republican. I'm not a Democrat. I'm a registered independent. And I sometimes vote red, sometimes I vote blue, but that's a good example of Colorado voters. We have more independents than we have either of the other two parties in a two-party system. But I wanted to illustrate to those folks that are listening and joining us today that we have a very strong model here in the state of Colorado, demonstrating emphatically the value of clean energy, the kinds of economic growth that we can achieve when we do these types of policies, and we really have to talk about policy and legislation when we talk about energy, and that and this is all without ever having put formally a price on carbon. The missing piece since I've gotten into this arena is a price on carbon. We came close in 2010 when Congress passed a cap and trade bill, but we failed to pull that through the Senate and put a bill on the president's desk. And so I know that there's various forms of carbon subsidy taxes around the world, but nothing uniform enough to really drive this conversation. We really do need to have a global price point on carbon that all the world agrees to. And if that one thing could come out of the COP process, we would achieve everything that we've been working for since the first COP happened some 26 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Fascinating. Thank you. We've kind of thought a little bit forward to the calendar this year and COP27 and beyond, but The elephant in the room, of course, is war and geopolitics. And has this provided us an opportunity, or is it a complete wasteful distraction with a war in Ukraine and perhaps worse still, geopolitical division between the West and Russia, China? I was somewhat dismayed. I saw one well-known blogger in the in our space saying that he was disappointed that instead of invoking, referring to President Biden, instead of invoking the Defense Production Act to spur renewables production and energy conservation, we've allowed a frenzy of activity on the Gulf Coast and construction ready to send LNG to Europe, and that a vice president of the American Petroleum Institute quoted, I think in the, this was the Washington Post, saying that he thought the outlook for the LNG demand is really robust going deep into the 2040s, even to the 2050s. Although I must say that much of Europe are mandated to shift to renewables. And it will take several years for capacity to be built to take LNG from the States or elsewhere. But what's your take on this whole crisis? And perhaps it's a case of whilst inflation is hurting all of us, especially the poor, energy costs, but not only energy costs, but it's the perfect storm. But if you look at the future of our civilization, maybe this huge pain that we're going through will perhaps force us to move to essentially a much cheaper form of energy longer term. So in every crisis, as the Chinese say, and I spent time living in China, there is opportunity.
Well, I embrace that. I think that crisis does equal opportunity. But we have a path before us. There's no doubt about it. You know, the entire human race there, you know, has a path. There's two paths. We can take the path to sustainability and regeneration of our soils, of our atmosphere. Or we can choose to continue to burn the fossil fuels that we know are collapsing the biosphere. This isn't a discussion point. This isn't an opinion. This is fact, scientific fact. But because the world is pegged to the global economy is pegged to the burning, the extraction and burning of fossil fuels, and that's an $80 trillion annual GDP, of which the United States is the number one economy, and China's number two, and the two countries have between them half of the world's economy, leaving out of that equation another 190 countries. We have to recognize that fact. We call that G2 over at AREI. And the US and China aren't at the best relations right at the moment. Largely due to the fact that Russia, under the leadership of Vladimir Putin, has attacked the Ukraine. And forced in the doing, the price of fuel around the planet, gasoline particularly, to go up by a magnitude of at least one third in this country, but also to force the demand for natural gas as more and more countries pivot away from doing business with China Russia. The price of natural gas and demand, therefore, is going up, particularly in the United States, which is a major natural gas producer, as we know. Why is this occurring? Well, I believe that, in fact, because the Ukraine presents such massive natural resources in terms of its ability to grow food, its access to water, that in a climate-constrained world where the population is growing and these natural resources are diminishing, that that becomes a very valuable asset, in fact. And that right now we're experiencing a tremendous upsurge in climate refugees. You might have seen that mentioned in the film that we showed at the beginning of our talk. And that film, by the way, was made in 2011. And yet it is still absolutely on the leading edge of the conversation today in 2022, some 11 years later. So what's to be done? A rapid transition to a clean energy future is the only thing that we have, that we can do, that that's intelligent to do, and to transition the world from a global GDP that is based on the extraction and burning of fossil fuels to a global GDP that's based on the rapid implementation of renewable, sustainable, and energy efficient technologies at the speed and scale necessary to solve catastrophic climate change. And that's the mission of AREI. If anybody would like to read that, please go to arday.net, AREDAY.net, and you can go to our mission page and read that statement. And that's what we're working to do. That's why we've been convening world leaders for the past 18 years to have this dynamic conversation. People like Ted Turner and Wesley Clark and Sylvia Earle and James Cameron. It's not just billionaire philanthropists and businessmen that have made their fortunes, but it's also people that are in the entertainment industry. That Sylvia Earle, my dear friend, who speaks for the ocean, I call her the Lorax of the sea. You know, she is so deeply concerned about what's happening in the world's oceans. And let's remember that the oceans comprise 71% of the Earth's surface. In truth, it should be called planet ocean. But here we are, and we know that the ocean is the biggest carbon sink in the world, and we know that the carbon that we've been burning is exceeding the capacity of the Earth to sequester, and that it's acidifying the oceans and the soils are breaking down. So what's to be done? We need to have, I like the model that my colleague Justin Winters and Spike Buckley over there at One Earth talk about, where there's three verticals. The first one is 100% renewable energy. That de facto means zero burning of fossil fuels. We have the technology and we know how to do this. Number two is we have to save half of the remaining biosphere. That's half of the Earth. And the third vertical of solution is that we must start to regenerate our soils, restore the soils, regenerative agriculture. There's some leading thought out there led by people like Paul Hawken and others in our space that suggests that we could pull all the carbon that we need out of the atmosphere naturally without direct air capture and these other geoengineered technologies, and that we can sequester that back into the Earth in a very organic fashion just by paying attention to how we produce food, how we till our soils, how we raise the animals. So all of these things can produce a marvelous economic boom all over the planet, and that we can get away from this war economy that we've started, unfortunately, in 2003 when the Iraq war began, and that now is continuing through Afghanistan and into the Ukraine. And all, of course, to duly note that these wars are fueled by, you know, oil, coal, and gas, and that this is producing, you know, a tremendous release further of the greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. I'd remind the audience that we are burning 40 billion tons per annum. And that's going on top of the 3,000 gigatons that's already been placed into the atmosphere. And these are causing feedback loops and tipping points that are coming so fast and furious that we can't even keep up with it. We know about the floods and the droughts and the forest fires, et cetera, that's happening, and the collapse of the fisheries. So To quote my friend Ted Turner, who so eloquently once stated, you know, we have to stop doing the dumb things and start doing the smart things, and we need to do it now.
I'm glad you mentioned sequestering carbon into or recarbonizing nature, because technologists frequently gravitate to all this exciting new tech. Like I provocatively said in a panel earlier in the day, one of my friends likes to remind me that the best technology we have for sequestering carbon is called a tree. I think we all call it a climate crisis at times, but essentially it's far more than that. It's an ecological crisis, because we are facing the biodiversity collapse, the sixth extinction, etc., etc. So if we're not planting a trillion trees or whatever the targets are, Paul Hawking, his book Regeneration, was quite well read going into COP26, and he has a couple of chapters on reforestation, etc. I think that really needs to be a big focus, not just sexy technology. Anyway, what you just said was a great segue really to the last topic, and probably the most important topic, really, in that I think you would agree, Chip, that throwing money and technology at this crisis is important but insufficient, in that the crisis, and you could see this in movies like Don't Look Up, perhaps a pretty strong satire of what's going on, if satire is the right word. But we're facing a wholesale civilizational crisis, and that there's a British futurist here who's quite influential, has done a lot of good things in the UK, advised Prince Charles, called Jonathan Porritt. And he said that one of the worst things that happened was that the climate emergency was put in the bucket of the environment, because it's so much bigger. And really, when that movie came out, I think it reminded us all that there's something wrong with not just our institutions, including the media, that there's something that we need to, in order to change our economies, and that is being addressed. And there are new economists like Kate Raworth, who wrote Donut Economics, and that's wonderful. But there's something deeper, a shift in mindset, consciousness, perhaps. And that's where I think that we need to look to the indigenous peoples of the world, as well as our own. There are movements such as Arnie Ness's Deep Ecology Movement, which is much more philosophical and spiritual, perhaps. But one thing that struck me at COP was a lot of people think that we need to listen to indigenous people because they've been abused over the years. Their lands have been stolen, and we owe them a debt because of that. That's absolutely true. But I would go a stage further, and I think Chip would probably, you'd agree with me, in that we actually can learn so much from the indigenous peoples. We still haven't worked out that their knowledge of ecosystems is highly developed in many ways. And I can give examples of that, where Western ecologists have learned from, for example, the elders of the Kogi tribe in Colombia, In fact, I'll give you a 10-second example. It's in the documentary by a BBC producer who there was a big argument where the Coggies were saying that damage downstream by the coast was causing immense problems upstream at the upper part of the mountain. And many ecologists were saying, well, that's impossible. The causation only works one way. And there was complete loss in translation. Everyone denied it, that the coastal settlements were affecting the mountain. Finally, I think it was an Oxford ecologist came out and he agreed with them. And there is lots of new science coming out about the web of life, the fungal internet, for example, which is just confirming things that the indigenous people have known for thousands and thousands of years. We're into extra time, but I think we can continue streaming, Chip, because this is a perhaps one of the most important things. So over to you on any responses to my thoughts there.
Of course. Well, unfortunately, I think we have lost our audience because we did have a hard stop at the 15 of the hour, but hopefully they can come back.
People can still continue to listen. We're okay.
Right. Well, what I'd like to say, Benjamin, about that is, first of all, in the 18 or 20 years that I've been active in this space, I've come to realize that not only do we need to change our energy systems, but we need to change our mind. We need to shift our consciousness to understand the nature of our very existence. Okay, all of the major and minor religions try to explain that to the population of the world, but then there's the actual truth of what our existence is. I maintain that the indigenous people have that one down. They really do remember the original instructions that were given to the human race that we have apparently forgot. Otherwise, we would not be drilling into Mother Earth, a living, breathing being like you and I, extracting the coal and the oil and the gas, which science tells us is the dinosaurs and the phytoplankton, the trees. And oh, by the way, it's our ancestors. It's what we become. It is us, okay? Let's not forget that little point that after we pass away, because you know what, folks? Nobody gets out of this alive. And, you know, we regardless are going to have to come to terms with the spiritual nature of our existence. And that's why I've been very happy to work with Mindahi Bastida and the Council of the Eagle and Condor and his dear colleague Ken from ICED, who together with the indigenous people led by the Kogi that you mentioned are working on something called the Four Earth Mandates. And the first mandate is that we must recognize the spiritual authority of the indigenous people. And the second mandate is that we must go and make spiritual payments at sacred sites around the planet. And the third mandate is that we must build 13 houses of original thought for the elders to transmit this knowledge to the youngers around the fire. And then the fourth mandate is that we must work across interculturally across with all the people of the planet in order to remember the original instructions. And I believe that's true at this critical time in our evolution, that it is in fact these ancient peoples who remember how it is that Mother Earth actually exists on the planet. Thank you for putting that up, Benjamin. This is an event that we produced recently in Sedona. There's Mindahi and his beautiful wife, Geraldine, along with JJ and Desiree Hertak, if you scroll down. And you can see that we're talking about these four earth mandates. And so Sedona constitutes one of the sacred places on the planet, along with Mount Fuji in Japan and Mount Kilimanjaro in Africa and Mount Elbrus in Russia and these other places, the big island of Hawaii, that are involved in literally how is it that Mother Earth, a living, breathing being, just like you and I, who gave birth to all of us, all life on Earth, is actually, in fact, working along with the other planets in the solar system? I would remind everybody that the moon goes around the Earth. We had a beautiful eclipse the other night in the blood moon. But the moon goes around the Earth once every 30 days, and the Earth goes around the sun once every 365 days. But the sun is moving around its center point once every 250 million years around the center of the Milky Way galaxy, which in itself is moving around its center point within the grand configuration of the universe. And that the last time we were here at this point in the galaxy, 250 million years ago, was when we had an extinction event that took out basically all life on the planet, down to 4% of everything, land and sea. So we're at a very critical point once again in our journey on this sacred Mother Earth, in this sacred universe. And I think it's very smart for us futurists, us advocates for renewable energy, for a sensible way of living on the planet, pay attention to the spiritual nature of our existence. I'm sure that Pope Francis would agree with me. I'm sure that the head of the Buddhist people in Asia would agree. So with that, I just want to tell you that, you know, it's not enough to shift to renewable energy from fossil fuels. We also must shift our consciousness, understand who and what we truly are on this sacred planet.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much, Chip, for your time, and thank you also for your invite to join the board of trustees of RA and RDE. It's been a complete honor to have a dialogue since COP with you, and also come to some of the sacred lands in the south of England. After COP, we went down to Avebury and Stonehenge and a few interesting sites. But it's wonderful it really encourages me that someone, a leader like yourself, that's very involved in the mainstream side of the technology, the economics. You were calling me during COP, and you were with the leaders of finance who were talking about allocating trillions of dollars of capital into climate. But it's very encouraging to me that we just lost Chip. It was very encouraging to me to see that Chip had this essentially a spiritual dimension, a philosophical dimension. So thank you for your service to Gaia, to the planet. And it's been a great conversation. Obviously, it could have been much, much longer. I hope we covered a few pertinent points for people today.
Thank you, Benjamin. And I want to also acknowledge and honor you, your leadership, your vision, and to thank you for escorting me to some of the sacred sites where you live, Avebury, the largest henge in the world, over to the Glastonbury Tor, to educate me on the work of the Druids some 5,000 years ago, and the knowledge that they had and brought forward then, and that we must really acknowledge that, you know, I just want to leave the folks with the indigenous quote that I love so much from Black Elk, who said, once the mystic from the Lakota Sioux tribe, you know, that this is not the real world. The real world is the one that's behind this one. And I thought that he said that so eloquently, you know, a man who grew up in nature and lived with nature, and that we have to remember Mother Nature, Mother Earth, and the sacred feminine planet upon which we all live. And that the 3.75 billion women on the planet must now take their rightful place in equality with men across all platforms, in all sectors and segments of society, in order to fulfill our destiny as a human race. And I think we're going to do it. I'm very, very optimistic on that point, that we're going to choose the good red road that to travel on. But we're going through this bumpy transitional period right now. And it'll be folks like you and your daughter, Gaia, and our wonderful partners around the world that are going to lead and facilitate this, with Shie and her parents, Mindahi and Geraldine and Eve Harrison, and so many others that we work with. So thank you, Benjamin, so much for inviting me. Thank you, Frank, for having this conversation on your platform. I would invite all of you to come and tune in to the R Day programming that we will continue to do. If you want to see what we've done in the past, I put up the website in the chat. Please click on that and go look at some of our videos of some of the folks that you've been so fortunate and lucky and honored to host over the years. Thanks, Benjamin. Thanks so much.
Wonderful. Thank you. And thanks to the audience for tuning in. And here we go.
Next time.